In this video, I'm going to show you how to use the observer pattern to create better separation between the various modules in your code. This pattern allows you to do some really cool things. I'm going to show you in an example. The observer pattern, also called the listener sometimes, is actually a classic from the Game of Four book on design patterns. Here's a class diagram. The important thing to note is that there are two roles, the subject and the observer. The subject does things and changes things and notifies observers of any changes that happened. There are several variations of this pattern. In this video, I'm actually not going to implement exactly the classical object-oriented version of it, but you commonly see it in event management system. And this is also the way that most developers use this pattern, handle user interface or general system events. And this is a pity because the pattern can be very powerful and work for you. And I'm going to show you how to use that to your advantage in a real world example. Suppose you write a backend API and you work on a register user function. Next to the database operations, this function also sends a message to Slack, to the sales team. It sends a welcome email to the user and it writes a log to a server somewhere. Now it's possible that you write a function that looks something like this. That's not good. Let's write something better. Let's first go over the structure of this example. This example is a little bit more involved than the previous ones because I wanted to show something that kind of approaches a situation like you would encounter in real life. The example that I have here imports a few functions from an API folder and it does a few things. It registers user, it sends a password reset message and it upgrades the plan of a user. Now, normally these things would be API calls. I just put them right here in the code just for testing purposes. If you look at the API folder, we have a user file and a plan file. And these actually contain the methods that I was calling just there. So in user, for example, we have the register new user, which takes a name, password, and email address. And we have a password forgotten function that takes an email address. So if you look at the body, there's one part which is actually the actual job that it needs to do, like creating a user. And then it posts a few messages, like here it posts a Slack message so the sales department can spam the person. It sends a welcome mail, it writes something to the server log, etc., etc. And these things are all imported from a lib folder. At the moment, this doesn't really do anything. Like, for example, this sent email message doesn't actually send an email, but it simply prints the message to the console. Similar for log and for Slack. In a real application, obviously, these would be integrated with the actual services that you'd be using. The database is the most complicated of all these things in the sense that it's also not a real database, but it creates an array of users. It has a class user that has a name, password, email, and a few other things. And then it has a few functions so you can create a user and you can find a user. So these are things that you'd normally have in a database driver, but here in this example, obviously, we're just doing that locally. Now, the problem with this code is that if you look at, for example, registering a user, you see it's doing a lot of different things. It's overall a method that has pretty weak cohesion. Not only does it need to know about database stuff, it also needs to know about Slack, email, logs, etc. Now, because register new user needs to know about all these particular functions, it means you also have a lot of different imports here. And similar for password forgotten, so it also does the actual job it needs to do, which is find the user and generate a password reset code. And then it sends a message, it writes something to the server, etc., etc. And for the part of the application dealing with upgrading the user's plan, it actually looks pretty similar. Part of this job is doing the changes in the database, which is finding the user and then upgrading the plan in the database. But then it also posts a Slack message, sends an email, writes something to the log. And you see also here, there's a lot of different imports. That means that upgrade plan, just like register new user, also has pretty weak cohesion and is directly coupled with all these very particular implementations. So that's not very nice. And we want to change that. And this is where the observer pattern, or specifically an event system, can really help you separate these things. So let's try to rewrite this application so that it uses events instead of these direct couplings between the code and the messaging. Python has several event libraries, but just to show how it works, I'm going to write my own. It's actually pretty simple. So let's add an event file here, event.py. And Basically, the event system is very simple. You have a number of subscribers that subscribe to different types of events. And whenever you post an event, you need to notify the subscribers. So let's create first a dictionary containing the subscribers. Now we have a dictionary. And then each item in the dictionary is going to be, for that particular type of event, the list of subscribers that need to be notified when that event happens. So let's add a subscribe method that does that for us. So we're giving it an event type, which is basically just a string, and a function that needs to be called. I'm not going to use type hints here for the function because, frankly, in Python, type hints for functions are a complete mess. The only thing we have to do when we subscribe to a particular event type is first check that there is already a list of that event type in the dictionary. If not, we need to create one and then add it to the list. So if not already in the subscriber list, then let's create a list of subscribers for this particular event. And we're directly appending the function that needs to be called to the subscriber list. Now again, there are already event libraries, so probably you won't have to write this yourself. I'm just adding it so it shows you how the pattern actually works. And then next to subscribing, we also need to be able to post events. So let's add a function for that as well. And normally when you post an event, you generally want to pass along some data with it. So if there are no subscribers, if the event type doesn't exist in the dictionary of subscribers, then we don't have to do anything. Otherwise, we're going to go over the entire list of subscriber functions and call each of those functions with the data. So there you have it. This is actually a complete, well, almost complete event system. And this actually works just fine. So now what we can do, we can go back to, for example, the user functions, like registering new user, and then replace all this stuff with simply a posting an event call. And as the data, I'm going to pass along the user. And same thing here. Then, of course, I also need to update my imports. And now I can remove part of the imports that are no longer needed here. And I forgot to add the user there. So much shorter this way. And now what I can do is that I can kind of group these different event handlers together in the way that makes sense. So for example, I could add here a Slack event handler. So I create a file Slack listener. Then what I'm going to do is import this post Slack message that I'm mainly going to use to do that. And of course I need the event library. And then the first thing is, let's add a function that handles a user registered event. And there we're going to put the Slack message to sales. And of course, don't forget to spam this person. There you go. So there we have our handle user registered event. No, I've got an import here. And I'm also going to add a function that sets up the event handling system for Slack messages. And it's going to call the subscribe method that subscribes us to a particular type of event. And then user registered event should be mapped to the handle user register event function. And now I can add more functions here, like when the user upgrades the plan, etc., etc. Now, in a similar way, I can do that for example, the system logs. So add the log listener file. I'll just copy this over because I need to do a lot of things the same. And now I'm not posting a Slack message, but I'm sending a system log event. And I can do the same. Let's say I want to have a password forgotten event. Like this. And I add a subscribe method call here. So I created these two collections of listeners. And in the observer, I then should import those and call this function so that the event system is set up correctly. So I'm not going to show how this works for all the functions and all the methods in this particular example, but I made a kind of complete version of this example where I rewrote this API so that it now uses this event system. That's also in the same repository. So if you check it out on GitHub, you can look at it and play with it yourself. So you see, we have here this event system that I just added, and we have a log listener with a couple of different event handlers, and we have Slack listener that looks the same, and we have an email listener that actually sends the emails. And the user and plan API access points now simply post an event instead of using directly sending emails, posting logs, or posting Slack messages. And something really interesting happened here. If you look at the way that it's now structured and the way that the imports are organized, is that here you see that the only dependency is on the event system. There's no longer any dependency on the type of specific type of message or specific type of things that you want to do depending on the event that occurs. And the same is for the plan. So there's just the database stuff and the event stuff. That's it. And the methods are also becoming much shorter. So we just have the database operation and then we post the event. If you look at the listeners themselves, you also see that the number of imports is actually pretty low. It just imports event stuff that it needs. And since this is a Slack listener, it needs the post Slack message import. And the same for the log and for the email. So using the event system in this way has allowed us to really separate the code much better. And if you look at what we do in the actual test program, so we're simply initializing the event structure by calling up these event handler setup functions. And then when I run this, you see that it generates a bunch of emails, Slack messages, log messages, etc. when I call these functions here. And now it's really nice that not only are the imports much better structured, there's less coupling. Because of that, some things are now much easier to change. So for example, if I want to temporarily disable Slack messaging, I could simply put this into comments. And if I run the code again, there are no more Slack messages. I didn't have to change anything in my actual API functions because these simply post an event and don't know anything about what happens after that. Now, similarly, if let's say I wanted to change from Slack to a different message provider like Microsoft Teams or whatever you use in your company, then also that would be a pretty easy change. I would simply disable this and then add a new listener for my new messaging service and enable event handling, and I'm basically done. I don't need to change anything else in the code. In the previous version, I would have to sift through each of the functions in my backend service and change the Slack specific part to a Teams specific part. So there you see a very clear example of how reducing coupling helps you write code that's much easier to change later on. And this event mechanism, I said it before, it's really, really useful for these kind of things. And a lot of people only use events for UI stuff like handling a button click or stuff like that. But just keep in mind that if you encounter this kind of structure or this kind of thing in your code, that events can really help to clean it up. You know, on this channel, I like to talk a lot about writing code and designing software. I don't like to just provide recipes like how to do X, but I'd like to think a bit more about why we're doing things the way that we do them. I've been teaching computer science for over 20 years and have started several software businesses, and simply following recipes never really led to good results for me. I really needed the understanding that's behind it. On the other hand, there are lots of tutorials out there about design patterns and design principles, but often the examples are not very practical. What I discussed today was a solution to a problem that I literally had a few weeks ago. I hope this video helps you think differently about how you write code. Let me know in the comments below what your thoughts are about this. You can find a link to GitHub repository containing the code that I worked on in this video in the description below. If you're enjoying this series, consider subscribing. Thanks for watching, take care, and see you soon.